Vice President Sara Duterte defending Pastor Apollo Quiboloy. In a video message published on X account of SMNI, Duterte said she joins those who are calling for justice and truth amid the allegations of abuse being thrown at Quiboloy. She also hit the credibility of witnesses presented during the Senate's inquiry into Quiboloy's alleged crimes. The Vice President believes Quiboloy is being persecuted. She also called the indefinite suspension of SMNI an issue of press freedom. A Philippine senator calls out embattled televangelist Apollo Quiboloy for setting conditions on attending a Senate hearing into his alleged abuses. This report.
Philippine Senator Riza Hontiveros slams the demand set by televangelist Apollo Quiboloy in exchange for his appearance before a Senate inquiry into his alleged abuses. Hontiveros is chairperson of the Senate Committee on Women and Gender Equality, conducting the probe. Among the more than a dozen conditions set by Quiboloy were for witnesses against him to appear at the hearing without concealing their faces. Quiboloy also wants to be allowed to cross-examine the witnesses, including Senator Hontiveros. But the senator admits her office has not received any official communication from Quiboloy's camp about the supposed demands, and only found out about it on social media. Another request allegedly by the controversial pastor is an all-expense-paid trip with hotel booking for him and his entourage to Manila.
Dinaig pa yung sampung utos ng Diyos. Masasabi ko lang dyan, bakit ang Senado ang mag-a-adjust sa kanya? The Senate will not bend its rules and procedures for you, Pastor Quiboloy. Even if you are, as you say, a self-appointed son of God, hindi kami para utusan mo.
Hontiveros has cited Quiboloy in contempt for repeatedly snubbing the hearings. Senator Robin Padilla, who has voiced his objection to the contempt citation, has until Tuesday to produce 8 signatories. But so far, Padilla and 3 other senators, Aimee Marcos, Cynthia Villar, and Bongo, have signed the written objection. Quiboloy recently appointed former President Rodrigo Duterte as the asset administrator of his religious group. Hontiveros says this is proof of the intertwined interests of the two and the possibility of Quiboloy escaping liability in the Philippines.
Ewan ko kung gusto nilang iparating, pero yung mensaheng nakakarating sa publiko, lalong dumadami ang mga issue. Lalong lumilinaw kung ganong ka-intertwined ang mga interes, maging ang mga economic interes ni Duterte at ni Pastor Quiboloy. May kasabihan pa nga, di ba? Tell me who your friends are and I'll tell you who you are.
Meanwhile, Senator Padilla has filed a resolution to investigate the National Telecommunication Commission's indefinite suspension of Quiboloy's media arm, SMNI. Padilla called the suspension of SMNI baseless and a denial of due process. House lawmakers who are probing the alleged franchise violations of SMNI again called on Quiboloy to attend the next hearing of the House Committee on Legislative Franchises on Tuesday. Failure to do so could lead to another contempt citation and arrest warrant for Quiboloy.
The U.S. announces over $1 billion worth of investments coming into the Philippines. U.S. Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo arrived in the Philippines Monday for Washington's Presidential Trade and Investment Mission. She says 22 American companies are looking to set up shop in the Philippines. She adds most of the firms will provide training on cybersecurity and artificial intelligence.
On this trip alone, these companies are announcing over $1 billion of U.S. investments, including creating educational opportunities to over 30 million Filipinos. Microsoft is going to deploy a Copilot chatbox tool and build proof of concepts with their Azure OpenAI service. Google is announcing similar investments. Semiconductor jobs are cybersecurity jobs. They are AI jobs, digital technician jobs, technical jobs.
Raimondo also met with President Marcos and his economic team. The country's economic managers are optimistic the investments from the U.S. will generate more jobs for Filipinos.
Skilling for AI and for cybersecurity. So I think that's a very, very big platform for our workforce to play in globally. We do not need to have our fellow Filipinos go overseas to work.
So Google, for example, and other tech companies in the U.S., they're targeting thousands of Filipinos to be given training and certification in digital competence.
A U.S.-funded civilian port will be built in the northernmost Philippine province nearest to Taiwan. Batanes Governor Marilu Kaiko says U.S. Army officials will visit next month to further discuss the new facility. Kaiko says the port can receive Taiwan-based Filipino workers who may have to flee in the event of a crisis there. The plan was revealed as more than 100 new reservists were deployed to Batanes. The Philippine Navy chief says they will be mobilized during national security situations as well as for humanitarian and disaster response. Over now to charter change. House lawmakers opened debates on relaxing economic provisions of the 1987 Constitution. RG Cruz reports.
House Majority Leader Manuel Jose de Lippe kicked off plenary deliberations at the House of Representatives on Monday. He explained how Congress can wield the power to regulate foreign investment limits and public utilities, education and advertising, in case resolution of both houses number 7 is approved. De Lippe said public utilities can be improved, higher education calibrated to better prepare students for work in the modern age, and more jobs in advertising created, all in the name of inclusive growth.
This crucial proposed amendment aims to break down the long-standing obstacles to create more dynamic and competitive market and ensure that our citizens have access to reliable and modern utilities.
De Lippe also shared the extensive discussions they had with experts.
We have spent a total of 6 days of committee meetings, equivalent to 2,485 minutes or more than 41 hours of exhaustive and lengthy deliberations to listen to a multi-sectoral and multidisciplinary expertise presented by respected resource persons.
Senior Deputy Speaker Aurelio Dong Gonzalez urged colleagues to heed the experts in favor of charter change, citing the need to make the Constitution responsive to the modern times.
They are one in saying that amending the restrictive economic provisions will pave the way for a better, more thriving Philippines. We need to accept that certain provisions of the 1987 Constitution, as a noble and well-intentioned as they are, I have already outlived its purpose.
Before the deliberations began, this lawmaker maintained that more foreign investments in the country can help shore up support against China's actions in the West Philippine Sea.
Any country with billion-dollar investments in the Philippines would also want to make sure that their investments are protected. So with more foreign direct investments, I think this is another clear way we can address the issue that is happening in the West Philippine Sea.
Meanwhile, Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel is unconvinced an endorsement from President Marcos will have any impact on how the Senate decides on its own charter change debate. Some House lawmakers believe there's no need for the President to further convince senators to approve charter amendments.
I think it's a little bit asking for a little bit too much of the president, because given that the president has already mentioned it many times in many occasions.
We should be deciding this matter on the merits of the bill itself rather than the personalities that are pushing for it.
The House leadership assured colleagues they will have all the opportunities to debate and ask questions until Wednesday, though deliberations are expected to be shorter compared to the time spent by the Committee of the Whole because congressmen will not be debating with experts. The House intends to approve the measure on second reading by Wednesday. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. now in Germany for a working visit. He is set to meet with the German Chancellor Olaf Scholz as well as business leaders there to convince them to invest in the country, especially in the field of renewable energy.
During our time in Germany and the Czech Republic, we will underscore our unwavering commitment to strengthening partnerships with like-minded countries, promoting the rules-based international order, which serves as a cornerstone of global peace and of stability.
Aside from his business agenda, Marcos also hopes to bolster maritime and defense cooperation with Germany amid China's aggression in the West Philippine Sea.
We wish to tap Germany's expertise in renewable energy to assist us in our energy transition efforts, as well as on manufacturing, healthcare, agriculture, aerospace, innovation, and startups, IT, BPM, minerals processing.
Marcos will be in Berlin until Wednesday before heading for Prague for a two-day state visit. Detained filmmaker Jade Castro and his companions released from jail. One of Castro's lawyers said a Catanawan judge junked the destructive arson complaints filed against the group, ruling out hot pursuit in the arrest, as claimed by the police. Castro and his friends had been accused of burning down a modern jeepney last January. The alleged crime was committed in the town of Catanawan in Quezon Province, less than an hour away from Mulanay, where Castro's group was staying. Witnesses and a CCTV footage also attest to Castro being in Mulanay during the incident. Now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Lori De La Cruz. Good morning, Lori.
Good morning, ma'am, and to all our viewers and listeners. At the moment, northeast monsoon is again affecting the extreme northern Luzon and it's causing partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated light rains over Cagayan Valley, Cordillera Administrative Region, and the Ilocos Region. So the whole northern Luzon is being affected with isolated light rains due to northeast monsoon. Meanwhile, Davao Region, Caraga, Aurora, and Quezon Province will have cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms due to easterlies. Then for Metro Manila and the rest of the country, they will have or we will have generally fair weather apart from localized thunderstorms. Right now, we're not monitoring any LPA or tropical cyclone inside the Philippine area of responsibility, and we have no gale warning raised over any parts of the seaboards of the archipelago. That's the latest from PAGASA. This is Lori De La Cruz.
Thank you very much for that update, Lori.